Hi everyone, welcome to today's webinar, Delivering All Port and Protocols, Network Protection to a Distributed Workforce. My name is Andy Nicholson. I'm on the marketing team here at Broadcom in the Symantec Enterprise Division, and I will be your moderator. Our presenters for today's session will be Tim Murphy, Symantec Network Product Marketing Manager, and Alex Campbell, Product Manager for the Web Security Service. Before we get started, just a few quick things to cover. If you have a question, just click on the Ask a Question button at the bottom of your screen. At the end of the presentation, we'll answer as many questions as we have time for. Under the Attachments section, you will find several useful documents and links, including the slides from today's session. At the end of the webinar, please be sure to take a moment and give us some feedback and rate today's session. And finally, this webinar is being recorded and you can access it anytime using the same link you used to connect to our live session today. So with that, let's get started. Tim, the floor is all yours.
Thank you, Andy, and thank you everybody for joining us today in this webinar. Today, we're gonna look at network security as a means to gain defense in depth protection. What's more, we're going to look at how you can do it better by delivering solutions out to the service edge and closer to your end users. Now, with a secure web gateway at its core, the final thing we'll examine is how you can extend your protection beyond the web. Now, the past few months, I've been watching a ton of old movies. And one of those movies is Office Space, and it came out about 20 years ago. Many of you may have seen it. It was about tech professionals at a company, and they were preparing for Y2K, and the movie made fun of, you know, typical office dynamic. Now, I remember watching this movie and speaking with others and saying, wow, that is just like my office. But after watching it 2 weeks ago, I realized it isn't. So much has changed in the past two decades. You know, it's crazy to think that employees were once reliant on fax machines, and people would walk orders down to sales instead of using a SaaS application. Memos and reports in the movie, if you remember them, they're pretty famous. They were manually passed around the office. And while we still work on weekends today, you don't have to go into the office to do it. I won't get into the physical security or the endpoint security in their office because they were quite humorous. But today, we look at network security. Unfortunately, many companies are managing their network security much like they did 20 years ago. Now, for some, and in the past, IT focused on building data center perimeters and setting proxies and firewalls and content analysis to create this walled garden. Now, traffic for remote workers and regional offices were backhauled to the corporate data center for security. But today's workers are really reliant on the web. They're reliant on SaaS applications. They're reliant on private applications. And to support this and all this, the new traffic that's hitting the networks, pipes need to get bigger and it's quite expensive. And you have to have a lot of people around just to manage the hardware. Now the problems don't stop there because backhauling adds latency, which results in a poor user experience. And perhaps worst of all, frustrated workers, they need to be productive and they may circumvent your security by using their own devices to get to the productivity tools that they need. Now, Gartner has seen this go on over many years, and they've looked at where they think the industry's headed, and they've provided this vision, what they're calling SASE. They're predicting that the models of network security and cloud security will become obsolete. Wait for the click here. And on the left, you can see that there's a typical network security stack, and the other cloud security stack. And they're saying that these will converge and create what's known as SASE, which is Secure Access Service Edge. Now, SASE is a convergence of these two industries, and it's primarily going to be delivered via the web. Now, Gartner has outlined their set of core and recommended and even optional components for SASE, and they're encouraging both the network and the security teams to embrace them. We at Symantec have, you know, committed ourselves to follow this model. And these are what you see on the screen are not Gartner's top 10 components, but we view are the 10 most important for companies that want to provide security out to the end users. Another key of SASE is to have a lot of POPs, and these stand for points of presence. And so as we continue to invest in our cloud security, we're also ensuring that we have the greatest number of POPs available to make sure that remote users are close to the security tools that they need to ensure low latency connectivity. Now, the benefits of SASE are very relevant today because many of you, like me, are taking this webinar from home. Besides my worry of having my dog start barking or one of my kids barging in or you know, bandwidth issues because everybody's hitting the Wi-Fi at the same time, the last thing I need is to have additional latency caused by my security tools. And if you out there are thinking, wow, I can't wait till we get over this and return to what we were doing before, I think you need to realize that what we're living in today is part of the new normal. Now, Gartner has conducted a couple surveys, and they asked both HR leaders and CFOs, the people, you know, they control the money, where they think remote or how they think remote work is going to be a part of their future. And many of them say that even post-pandemic, a lot of more people are going to be working from home. And so, you know, one thing we're encouraging our customers to do is plan for that new future. And if you know, think it's just you know, a handful of people who are envisioning this, it's really the biggest names out there in technology. I mean, Google is already anticipating that a lot of people are going to be working home for you know, an extended period of time. And Twitter is saying, hey, you can work home from home forever. So companies are realizing there are benefits and there's drawbacks to having a remote workforce. But it's definitely going to be a part of what is our new normal. Now, this slide here, I want to share with you how Symantec is delivering SASE and supporting that remote, you know, work from home situation. And it all starts with our endpoint, where it provides, you know, security for the endpoint, but also steers traffic to our web security service. Their firewall rules are applied from our cloud firewall service for non-web traffic. Content is decrypted and inspected according to your policy. We can apply content analysis, sandboxing, and for, you know, the truly unknown, even web isolation. And all this traffic can also be sent to our leading DLP. Web security service can also steer traffic for SaaS applications to our leading CASB solution, CloudSOC, which also integrates with our leading DLP. I keep seeing leading a lot, but these are truly leaders in their areas. Now, for private applications and for IaaS applications, web security service can direct traffic to Secure Access Cloud, which is our software-defined perimeter solution, sometimes known as ZTNA, and make sure that adequate protection is you know, applied for those applications. And let me add again, this connects to CloudSOC and it also enables DLP protection. Finally, users can be verified with multi-factor authentication. VIP is one of our solutions, but we can certainly authenticate with many others out there. And we realize that not everybody's going to be working from home in almost any situation. Symantec Web Security Service can work with leading SD-WAN partners to direct regional office traffic to our web security service and provide many of those SASE values that we saw from Gartner from the network side. And here we take a look at Gartner's key components. And you'll see that we're able to check off quite a few of the boxes that Gartner is recommending. We don't check off all the boxes. And frankly, I don't think that there's anybody out there that does. But providing that integrated SASE solution, or at least providing a platform to get there, is something that we take a lot of pride in. And this is going to direct how we move forward in our product roadmaps. So today I want to stop and allow us to take a deeper look at web security service. And with that, I'm going to hand it over to Alex Campbell, who's going to drive us from here.
Thank you, Tim. I'm product manager for the web security service at Symantec, and so I'm glad to step in and explain where it fits into the overall SASE model that Tim has just spoken to. Web security service is that intermediate spot between the endpoint, you know, the edge, as in the SASE moniker, and the internet. It is that key integration point, as the previous slide showed, and it's a intentionally distributed multi-tenant customer or multi-tenant architecture spread around the world. Our goal is to have POPs and data centers in as many countries near our as close to our end users as possible. This provides the lowest latency access to our infrastructure, as well as giving those users a really high quality in-country experience. And we, in order to do this, we've worked through the connectivity models. Tim spoke to our endpoint agents. We also support standard IPsec or SD-WAN vendors, and we've partnered with many to bring the traffic to our POPs. And then our POPs themselves are hosted in high-quality data centers around the world, many of them now in the Google public cloud, which itself has the world's best private fiber network, which we get to take advantage of. And so that brings the traffic to us at low latency. We have the multiple ways of connecting. And then on top, then it's, as it flows through our architecture, we take advantage of our industry-leading proxy system. The Symantec proxy is derived from the same technology as our industry-leading on-prem proxies. In fact, as long as there has been a secure web gateway analyst review of secure, then ProxySG and the Symantec technology has been in the leader's position. That lets us have that full file extraction so that we have control of web traffic at the deepest granularity. We're not just watching packets flow by, we're actually reassembling the entire object, doing the deep inspections as necessary, and then letting that proceed for web traffic. And that's and proxy is necessary for other technologies such as SSL and TLS decryption and proper authentication. So all of these benefit greatly from the history that Symantec has, and that's why we built our architecture around that. But that's not the only piece of the infrastructure. Once the traffic is in WSS, we are fully integrated to all of the other technologies that were spoken to, the SASE checkboxes there that we were mentioning, web isolation, giving you a virtual air gap, very useful for those gray area websites, not risky enough to block, but not completely trusted. Data loss prevention, as we're one of the best in the world on that, and that gives us the ability to really protect customers from uploading data that's of personal or private information. Cloud application security, that's obviously for all the SaaS applications out there, gives you that deep control, not just allow, deny, but this user is permitted to do these actions in that particular tool. And the URL filtering and content application controls, these are actually one of the bread and butter base level features. Everyone has this. Everyone considers it part of the table stakes for being a proxy architecture. But what's behind that categorization, what's behind that application detection is really a key piece of this. Symantec has the world's largest civilian intelligence organization. We gather data from all the Symantec customer base. We gather data from all the Norton customer base. We're always monitoring what is actually going on the internet. And so we make sure that we are tracking websites that newly appear or websites that have not been active and then become active. All of these things feed into our dynamic risk assessment and give customers that ability to write that fine-grained control that they want for their business policies. And that protection continues when the object comes back with actually applying, as was mentioned, malware analysis based on the Symantec technology stack, as well as full detonation in a virtual sandbox if necessary. So we have a lot of different technologies that come into play as part of WSS, but today we're going to focus on the Cloud Firewall service, which is a key addition to the overall platform. This is a tool we are very happy as part of our solution, and as I'll speak to in a moment, it is a key part of the web security platform, even though it covers the non-web. But let's talk first about what the global internet looks like today. If you say to somebody, "Oh, I went on the internet," you probably were thinking about a web page. If you tell somebody, "I'm going to go do some work," you're probably using a web application, whether it's a SaaS or a cloud, or something else. I mean, HR teams around the world have moved to SaaS-based models. Sales management teams have moved to cloud-offered solutions. We're all on a web-based conferencing tool right now. So the HTTP and HTTPS protocols have really won the day. They are 90%+ of the world. We have some data from various vendors that monitor the active internet access. And when you parse through it, it's clear HTTP has won. Well, say web has won. So that's why it's very important that we have that proxy architecture at the core of WSS. But the other piece of that, the everything else category, still exists. And there are really very important reasons that we want to give that deep control to our customers, because it's not an all or nothing. There are things that you want to allow in the other category, sanctioned apps. There are things that you want to deny, you know, the risky, dangerous apps. And often you need that to be a very granular feature set. A few key use cases to capture that. One is, it needs to be part of a cloud architecture, which we've done with WSS. And so that protects your roaming users no matter where they go. If you pick up your laptop and you go to a coffee shop, or more commonly today, you're sitting at home working on at home on a laptop, then it's really important that the controls follow the user and they continue to provide that protection regardless of how they move through the network. And when they're back on-prem, you don't want to necessarily drive that user to a different set of technologies or a different policy set. They really want the same continuous policy rules to follow the user regardless of where they go, something consistent. And many multinationals, many large organizations have over time collected different technologies in different branch offices. It's very expensive to try and upgrade that all at once. Far better to just bring it all to WSS and apply one consistent policy rule set so that you know all the data is being protected and it's all the same as people see when they go home. I mentioned earlier the granular use cases, and I touched on it a little bit in terms of sanctioned and unsanctioned, but let's talk through one of those key examples. As an IT organization, many times people need to have remote access and to manage servers. SSH is a tool for this, RDP is a tool for this, and you want the cloud firewall to tie into that authenticated user group knowledge so that you're protecting the users and giving them the right level of access. At the same time, someone who's not in the IT organization, marketing, for example, sorry, Tim, will have to be blocked from that, because as a just best practice policy, you should have a least privileges view and minimize the risk factors for the risk of access that users have. And so that's one of those values to tying this all together, is adjusting your business policy rules to match your WSS or to match your security rules that you have in the internet. Let's take a quick look at what and how it all works. So what we've done in the WSS architecture is after traffic arrives at our POP, we have layered in a cloud firewall layer. And this does the packet level analysis that we spoke to earlier. It's fully integrated to our authentication systems, so we know at that point who a user is. If we find out later that the username through other mechanisms, that information is fed back to the cloud firewall to inform its future decisions. And as packets flow, Cloud Firewall is capable of applying deep application analysis and scanning, so you can write policy rules based on what is actually in the flow. Anything that passes Cloud Firewall does proceed on to our proxy layer, and so you have that opportunity for a second bite of the apple, that those deep controls I spoke to. And in fact, the proxy layer is monitoring for anything that is a known protocol, web, HTTP, HTTPS, and uplifting that into the full proxy architecture. So you're really getting a combined solution that brings the best of all worlds in terms of protecting your users and giving you the controls you want. Across that, we of course are logging every transaction, whether it's in the cloud firewall or in the proxies, and that then informs our in the cloud reporting architecture. Those logs are available for on-prem use also. So a great deal of technology here, but in the end, it's very simple and very tied to what we do with the the needs of our customers' business policies. There I clicked. Let's take a quick look at the UI itself. I want to show this because it's just better to see than to talk about. Here's an example policy in the UI. Just like every other part of WSS, it's managed through our cloud-based portal, so it's reachable through an HTTPS connection. And it follows the same basic metaphor as any firewall rule that anyone's ever written before. Top to bottom, left to right, the rule. Top to bottom, the rules execute. First rule that matches is the last rule that's looked at. And here you can see we have various combinations of configurations so that people can write the policy rules they want. In fact, I have in this example, Alice and Bob are part of the IT, are allowed to go to websites, to a particular site. Actually, Alice and Bob are denied, excuse me. And then the George, who's my example of an IT staff guy, is allowed to go to one specific SSH website, whereas SSH in general is blocked. So this is a kind of made up example, but it gives you that feel of where the policy can give you that control as it goes out. The rules editor itself, if you opened any one of those rules, is very similarly laid out. It gives you those options, the source, whether it's based on IP or by user or group or some combination, the destination, whether it's IP or a host name, and then what's going on, what kind of service is it, what kind of port and protocol is it, is all available for very simple rules. And you can write allow, deny as necessary. The checkbox below that about application monitoring is actually where this stops being a standard firewall and starts being a next-gen firewall. Application monitoring turns on the feature that lets a few packets flow so that you can see what is the actual protocol itself. And that application detection is driven by a database that we're always keeping up to date. And so you have that easy to write policy exemptions. You can write your rule set that says, this is what I expect to happen, but if I see something else, I need to apply this other option. So we've tried to make this as simple for customers as possible so you can basically tune it to what you need in your environment. So all of this doesn't matter much. If the traffic flows through and you don't have a way to actually see what happened, if things were blocked and you don't know it. So that's where logging and reporting is very critical. And so we've made that available here and it's fully integrated as part of the WSS reporting architecture. Just like everything else, we have dozens of pre-configured reports ready for you, single click away. Any one you see, you can drill into layer upon layer as deep as you need to fully understand that transaction. And all of them can be saved, scheduled and emailed even, so you can automate as much of your day-to-day necessary reporting and never have to touch the user interface except for those cases where you want to do something new and custom. We also drive everything here on the right with the dashboards. They are really just reports, so anything you build as a report, any pre-configured one or anyone you make that's custom can become a dashboard, just so you have a rapid view of things when you first log into the portal. So really, we're driving this to make this business ready for you, for our customers, and so that they have that view into the Cloud Firewall service. Just as a final note, this is exactly like the rest of WSS reporting for the proxy infrastructure. And so anything I've shown you here is basically, you're now fully trained on. Now, I wanted to talk a little bit about a real example. A lot of people talk about theories in these and how the things will go. But as part of a SASE transition that Gartner is predicting, we are actually seeing this happening in the real world in real time. And here's an actual example with real data from a customer that recently had some experiences. This was a long time multinational customer. They have on-prem architecture using the proxy SG tied into the rest of the Symantec portfolio, giving them that full secure web gateway controls. Of course, they have their own firewalls on-prem. And they were in a position where they had installed a few years ago the web security service agent onto all of their laptops. They did it for a very obvious reason. When those laptops went home on nights and weekends, they would often come back infected And so there was a lot of reasons to protect that traffic, even when people went home. And referencing back to our office space example, they did have employees working on the weekends too. So it was an important time to protect them, make it work, and make it available to them. Fast forward to March 2020. As the news of the pandemic started to broil and roll, they said, we might have to take action on this. So on March 10th, they sent home as many employees as they could and said, we're going to do a dress rehearsal. They basically had them all go home and start working at home. Do everything you're going to do a normal day. Take all your phone calls, do your WebExes or Bright Mails or what, or Bright Talks or whatever you need to do from home. And they saw an absolutely seamless transition. Not a single issue that related to the web security. Obviously, they probably had to deal with a few extra phone calls for people saying, well, I need to make sure you call my mobile today instead of my office line. But it was a really easy transition for them. So much so that as the news continued to come in, as they continued to see issues rolling around the world, they went ahead and preemptively said, you know what, this Friday, everyone start working from home. And the transition was, again, completely seamless. Thousands of employees moved off-site, and they are continuing to stay in that mode right now. So it is the new normal. I think it's going to be something we're going to see a lot of our customers using. Even if you don't have a reason to go home again and work from home again, it's going to be something every customer is going to have to plan for, because this might not be the last time. And in the terms of this customer, they're now saying, you know what? I think Cloud Firewall is a good add-on. And it's exactly that, just an add-on. Once you have WSS in place, you just turn it on. So we're ready to go with that, and we'll be working with them right now. Let's take a few questions.
Thank you, Tim and Alex, for that excellent presentation. We will move to questions now. So if you would like to ask a question, again, the way to do that, just on the bottom left side of the screen, just click on Ask a Question, and you can submit that to us. The first question that we have is for Tim. And the question is, Tim, when will this product be available?
Yes, that's an easy question. That's why you sent it to me. But the product is available today. We rolled this out. I think it became GA early January, late December. But it's available today. You have WSS. And if you're interested in it, please reach out to your account teams.
Okay, great. Good news on that. Next question, I'm going to throw this one over to you, Alex. The question is, can Cloud Firewall service be purchased without WSS web security services?
So we've architected the service around the web security service, as the name implies, built around that 90% of web. And in keeping with that, we are servicing this as purely an add-on to the web security platform. The need really, it would be short-sighted of us to offer it any other way. So it is always just going to be an add-on, but we do consider it a must-have to complete your security portfolio.
Great. The next question I think is also for you, Alex. And the question is, can customers import existing firewall configurations?
So we looked at this a lot. Being a multi-tenant architecture across the world, we of course are managing the configurations on all those those data centers and all those POPs for all customers. That means that we need to really drive the configuration through our architecture. And so for that reason, at this time, WSS is the portal is the way to configure Cloud Firewall. We're going to continue, of course, looking at options, but that is the case as of today.
Okay. Very good. We've had several more questions come in, so kind of taking a look here. I think this one would be for you as well, Alex. Question is, can you identify, if possible, any current connection services to WSS that do not support all ports and protocols and or CFS as well? Not all offerings offer all configuration support.
This is a good technical question. The Cloud Firewall presumes that you are sending non-web traffic to WSS. And so those architectures in which we have a VPN tunnel that brings the traffic into our architecture, whether it's a IPsec connection or an SSL VPN from our agents, those can take advantage of Cloud Firewall. And in fact, our WSS agent is fully plumbed and architected right now to be able to, with a flip of a switch, start sending all packets to WSS. The other forms of connection method, and it was on one of the earlier slides where we showed proxy forwarding, or if you use an explicit proxy connection, those are, of course, by definition, just web, because only web proxies, only browsers understand proxy settings. Only proxies speak can only forward proxy set traffic. So in those cases, you're continuing to be a pure proxy-based architecture. Again, very valuable and covers the 90%, but doesn't include Cloud Firewall as an option.
Okay. Here's one of those, I guess, sometimes controversial questions, I guess, but I'll throw it out there anyways, because they're asking about a competitor. So Alex and Tim, do you want to just make some comments? Someone's asking about how we compare it with Zscaler.
Well,
go ahead, Tim.
No, I was going to say that some of the differences that are there, like to be polite in these webcasts, but we do support hybrid implementations. And I think that many would agree that our integrations are quite good. I would argue that we're a notch above, and some of these leading services that solutions that we integrate with that I've mentioned on that one slide help us separate ourselves from the crowd. But Alex?
That's absolutely true. I was going to say, in terms of a SaaS vision, we have even more complete solution, given that we own the endpoint technology as well. In my mind, the E in SASE, which is in Gartner's world is Edge, also includes endpoint, because when a user goes home and roams home, they need the full security of a malware protection stack, as well as the rest of the network protections that we're offering. So as a security practitioner, I would always argue you need the full security suite, and we're in a better position to deliver that.
Yeah, makes sense. Thanks for that, guys. The next one is, I think this will be for Alex. Please identify what changes would be required, if any, if a customer is using policy managed by UPE, using Management Center to control WSS policy instead of WSS built grouping based rules built in WSS GUI. So enjoy all those acronyms, everyone.
I was going to say the acronyms we spin are quite impressive. As an industry, we love them. UPE stands for Universal Policy Enforcement. It's a feature that allows customers to take their on-prem proxy policy that they've been managing through the central management tool for proxies and treat WSS as another proxy. So they can take the proxy policy and just ship it to WSS, and we enforce it, even if the user flies to the other side of the planet. This is great. This is perfect for our customers because, as I said, we're longtime leaders in this space. Many of our customers have spent years building out their policy and understanding how it fits their business needs. So being able to take their proxy policy and bring it directly to WSS is a key feature. Cloud Firewall being a new service, new add-on to the service, and with a different architecture of its rule set, you're no longer based on a proxy, so it's a little bit different. You have to think about packet level policy. It is not covered by UPE. There's no on-prem equivalent in the Symantec provided management tools. And so what happens if you're a UPE customer, you're continuing to manage your proxy policies just like you always have on-prem and just pushing them to WSS. And for Cloud Firewall, you will be using the WSS portal.
Great, thanks, Alex. Next one is, can you talk a little bit about the CFS, I assume that's Cloud Firewall Security Maturity Roadmap. When will you be able to group services, networks, et cetera, and use them across firewall rules?
This is a user interface question about managing the rules. And I believe that's actually possible today. I may be misunderstanding the question, but the user interface is fully live today. We'll always be taking feedback on how to improve our user interface and usability, and we'll happily take a look at that offline. but I think that's one we can follow up on separately.
Okay, thank you. Next one is, let's see here. I'm trying to understand and not seeing it yet. What are the advantages of the Cloud Firewall policy versus the WSS policy that are proxy policies?
So I think I may have gone past the slide a touch fast then, but the WSS policies provide a control, as historically controlled, what you're doing with that 90% of the traffic that is HTTP, HTTPS. And so that is a far better solution because it is has the depth and controls and ties into every other integration across the infrastructure because we have the full packet. We aren't looking at packets. We're pulling out the entire object within the HTTP, HTTPS stream. That is the central core and value of a proxy-based architecture. It's the true way you deliver real protections for HTTP and HTTPS. What Cloud Firewall adds to that is the coverage for the other protocols, because there are many other legacy protocols that are not file-based, protocols that don't transfer data in any meaningful way. There may be one or two bytes at a time. And for those cases, a customer wants to be able to control what's coming and going from their remote users. You don't want a laptop to be sitting out at the edge of their network and have full unfettered access to every possible destination on the internet except for web traffic. I mean it's not quite leaving the barn door open, but it's leaving a very large doggy door at the bottom of the barn door. So I think this is important to provide that full protection across all ports and protocols. You need the combination of Cloud Firewall and WSS.
Very good. Alex, I'm going to give you a break just for a minute and pass one back over to Tim. A question for you, Tim. Are you thinking about potentially replacing VPN technologies in the future, like Prisma, Zscaler in the future?
We currently have a VPN replacement technology, and it once again is one of those that I showed on that screen where we integrated WSS with our Secure Access Cloud. That is a software-defined perimeter solution. Zscaler has one. I know that that's similar, a software-defined perimeter solution. What we do, though, what we think is different from them is we provide access to layer 7 type access to applications, and we're able to control exactly what you can get to and what you can't. I believe that they provide that more layer 4 type access to your content, but I think there's risks of lateral movement is what I once heard the product manager talk about. So yes, we do. I know that they have them as well. Would love to set up another webcast where we talked about Secure Access Cloud because it's a pretty fascinating product.
We'll definitely do that for sure. The next one is a roadmap question. We hear this from time to time, people asking about a central management console. Can either of you comment about our plans around a central management console for WSS? Okay, go ahead, Alex.
So the one of the real values of Symantec's portfolio is its breadth of features and functions. And sometimes that leads to multiple different products appearing to be separate companies, or at least separate products. When we spoke to WSS and CASB and DLP, they do all have their own consoles. Historically, that's been the proper way for a large organization to manage those tools, because DLP is usually, I can't really think of a time that a full DLP, serious DLP installation is managed by the people who are managing the firewall rules. It's usually a completely separate team. And for the large companies of the world that need that separation of duties, they probably don't want the guy who's changing the paper in the printer or plugging the wires into the router to see the kind of data that's being detected by DLP. Now that said, one of the benefits of our recent acquisition by Broadcom and our renewed investment in several engineering projects is that we have just completed a migration for all the products, WSS, DLP, and so forth. We're all migrating into a single authentication platform that allows an administrator to access any and all portals with one password. A few of the other portals are still catching up, but we're all on the same architecture, and it's going to be the path forward. And that is the first step along the way to a single management console, where it's just really a click away to be on any of these toolings. Longer term, we'll see what we do about merging the overall workflows. Certainly, I've seen some discussions about that, but we don't have a timeline on that right now. I can tell you, though, the single login is coming this year.
Great. Thanks, Alex. Next question is about the WSS agent. Says the WSS agent can send all the traffic to the WSS already, and WSS can apply proxy policies that are very granular and can block, allow SSH ports, URLs, category, applications, authenticata. Still don't see what the Cloud Firewall add-on to the WSS brings to the table. Can you provide?
I think this is a, they're asking you hard questions to read out, aren't they? The gist of this is that yes, the agent can send all traffic to WSS, but it will not until you turn on Cloud Firewall. And that's because we recognize that what's really going on is you don't want to necessarily route it. You know, we want to give customers the choice. Do you want to route everything to WSS or not? And if you say yes, then all the packets come to WSS. Then the question is, do you want to have firewall controls on the non-web portions? So one mistake in that was to say that you can control SSH with proxy controls. In the historical architecture, SSH was not controlled through web security service policy. Cloud Firewall brings that technology, and so you have that deep control. Also, with our application monitoring that's built in, if SSH is running on a non-standard port, the application monitoring in Cloud Firewall will detect that and allow you to have those deep controls based on the packet inspection. And so there's a lot of value to combining the two, and that's why we've put them in the same UI so people can actually see them and manage their policy logically. Again, the UI itself, and I didn't call this out, is structured in the same way that the traffic flows from left to right, Cloud Firewall first, and then the proxy policies follow on that same on the UI as you click through the tabs.
Okay, thanks, Alex. There's a follow-up question to the VPN. So, Tim, I think we'll go back to you. The question on VPN replacement was more around client-based VPN, having the WSS agent include VPN capability back into the internal corporate network, as well as connectivity to WSS.
Tim? Yeah, Tim, do you want me to take this one?
Yes, please.
Okay. I think this is true that the WSS agent brings you to WSS. WSS lives in those POPs around the world. What this is asking us to do is provide a route back to the on-prem customer network. And that is exactly what the Secure Access Cloud offering does. As Tim said, we have an excellent, it's called, the Gartner term for it is called a software-defined perimeter. There's also a Forrester analyst calls it the ZTNA or our zero trust model. But all of these are the idea of being able to access an on-prem resource in a very controlled way with full authentication and deep controls on what is possible, what is allowed from anywhere on the planet. So it is a VPN replacement in the sense that it removes the need for a VPN entirely. And it can coexist perfectly with WSS. It can be used independently. So the Secure Access Cloud is definitely a feature that sounds like there's a lot of interest. We need another session on, and I think we can cover that in the future.
Yeah, I made a note of that. We'll definitely get one scheduled. Okay, I think we just have one more question. This is, the question is, and if either of you want to comment, great, but it's probably for Alex. We are one of the early adopters of Symantec's SaaS platform, including WSS, after we decided to upgrade and expand our existing Symantec infrastructure. However, due to the absence of a POP in Greece, our egress traffic goes through Italy. This impacts our business adversely since our services are dependent on location data. As a result, we have not been able to utilize WSS for almost a year now. Does Broadcom plan the creation of a POP in Greece, and if so, when?
So this is an interesting one. The nature a cloud-based service is that your POPs become the point where you leave the network, no matter where the user is. We've done a significant build out over the last several years to put data centers, I can't even keep count, it's 11, 12, whatever it is, inside of Europe and in the various countries because of this very issue. We are always monitoring and managing our business and the business needs. And so this would be a great opportunity to understand what's needed inside of Greece. However, there's an alternative, and I'm gonna harp on it a little bit, is we provide a fully featured on-prem technology solution. It can solve this very easily for those remote offices that are in places that are not managed. And as I mentioned earlier, you can have a single policy both in WSS and on-prem so that your users see the exact same experience. So I think this is a case where something between a hybrid deployment, something between a future business analysis of whether we put a data center or a POP inside of Greece. These are all options. There are probably a few more that we could talk about with Secure Access Cloud, but I'll leave that for a different day. And so it's one of those that you should contact your technical sales teams and see what they can do to help you out with that, designing a proper solution.
Great. Okay, we just had one more question come in, and then we'll go ahead and wrap the webinar. Before we do that, is why we're kind of tying things up here. Please be sure to take a moment and rate our webinar before you log off. There's also several attachments available to you. We have several reports, the slides from today's webinar, and several other useful things. So be sure and click on the attachments and download those before you log off. So let's take this last question, and then we'll wrap for today. Question is, future of proxy for customers has been to expect policy and all settings to be created, managed in Management Center with SGOS 7.x. Since WSS has a similar infrastructure or proxy, when can customers expect the OS and WSS to match what a customer would be using on-premise? Proxy SGOS 7.x has many benefits for early adopters. When can customers expect to leverage such benefits and offerings of these improvements in WSS?
Oh boy, we've got some great customers here today. And I want to thank everyone for coming. I mean, this shows that people really do understand the value of the Symantec products and portfolio. And I'm so glad to talk to so many customers. As this question said, the SGOS, the operating system that runs the on-prem proxy SG technology, is the basis of WSS. We've used the same architecture and the same, we've modified it, of course, to be multi-tenant and other tooling to fit into WSS. It is currently running on the latest version of the 6.x code base. That's WSS is. The on-premise proxies released last year a version 7 with a few additional technologies. And we are actually in the process of scheduling that rollout in WSS. As you might imagine, being a cloud offered service, we have to are very diligent to carefully plan these rollouts. And we want to also make sure we're driving the highest possible quality. That is a key feature of the Broadcom way, quality over features. We want to make sure that the service is stable and providing the value. And then we start adding the features. And with our most recent migration into the Google Cloud, that's been going on about the last 3 months or so, we did pause rolling out SGOS version 7 into WSS. So our plan is later this year, we'll be proceeding with that. This is one of those where the policies you write on-prem, can completely be pushed into WSS through Management Center. And it's what I believe is really being asked here is some of the additional features and functions that SGOS 7 brings. When will those be in WSS? And so I'll say we're working on those. Our target would be late this year. Is a goal to start rolling that out. I can't give you a specific date because we'll do it at the right speed to do it properly.
Great stuff. Thanks so much, Alex, and thank you, Tim, for your great presentation and answering many questions that have come in. We also want to thank all of our attendees today. Thanks so much for taking time out of your schedule and joining us for today's webinar. Again, if you had to leave or missed any part of it, you can always go back and listen. The same link will work for the recording as you used to join today. And with that, we'll wish you a great day and a great week, and we'll see you next time. Thank you.